regional economic integration, some other learning outcome for today: regional integration and economic blocks, level of regional integration, the leading economic blocks in the world, what are the advantages of the regional integration, what are success factors for regional integration. There are some disadvantages in terms of ethical dilemmas and drawbacks, and finally the management implications of the regional integration. A quick introduction about regional economic blocks. As you all know, globalization has increased the interactions between national economic system. We call this independent of nation, interdependencies, interdependencies of nation. Of nations. So, with the globalization, we are increasingly, witnessing interdependencies of nation. Interdependencies of nation means country A has to dependent with country B, country B interdependent with country C, C interdependent with A, A with C, and etcetera. We call this interdependencies of nation. This requires closer economic integration among countries in order to be competitive in the global economy. They have to be interdependent. Why? Then we go back to our comparative advantage of nation. We have to fall back to the theory that we learn in the chapter 6. So, don't be so happy when I say that there is no need to read chapter 6. But when I come to this chapter, we have to fall back to the theory. So, you must know the theory. Then, competitive advantage of firm. Again, you have to use a theory to explain. So, because of globalization, the interdependencies of nation become very severe, and we are witnessing already by having good interaction between A, B and C, C and B, C and A. Why? Why this is important? This is important because based on theory, comparative advantage of nation, we have to do trade between countries, and based on competitive advantage of firms, we have to do trade between countries in order for us to enjoy the competitive advantage, as we learn in the chapter 6 as well. So, this requires closer regional integration among countries in order to be competitive in the global economy. Why? It's because of this. The trend of protectionism. So, whenever you want to do trade between countries, of course, the dilemma will come in. Dilemma. In Bahasa Malaysia, we could spell dilemma. So, what is the dilemma? The dilemma of protection, protectionism. The dilemma of protectionism will come in. Dilemma of protectionism means when everyone wants to compete with each other, then the protection will come in. Protection such as imposing tariff, imposing quota, imposing administrative policies, imposing that, imposing this, and so on. Okay, so we call this dilemma of protection. Why? Because we want to be competitive. Subsidy, right? All will come in, as we learned in the last week lecture about government intervention. Because why? They want to make sure their own company in their own country survive. They cannot compete with other nation. So they start to protect. So dilemma of protection comes in. So this explains what I am mentioning just now. The trend of protectionism and trade distortion in certain region has intensified the need for countries or economic system to cooperate. Because of this protectionism, economic blocks become very crucial. Economic blocks become very crucial. Economic blocks become very crucial. What is economic block? We are going to learn now. So the background of the story is, because of globalization, interdependencies become very severe, A and B, C and D, D and A, and so on. Then the competition become very severe as well, because of the competitive advantage of nation and also the competitive advantage of firm that they want to compete. Then the government started to protect. Dilemma of protection comes in. Now the economic blocks become very crucial. Why? So that we can eliminate the dilemma of protection. Why this is very, very crucial? This is very crucial because to eliminate protection. To eliminate protectionism, to eliminate protectionism. This is a wonderful graphic, you know. Of course, not so beautiful as you draw. This is a wonderful graphic. So I want you to capture this in your notes somewhere. A general definition of economic integration. What is that? The merging of economies and economic policies two or more countries in a given region. So the economic block means what? Merging of economy and economic policies of two or more country in a given region. I'm going to show you some examples now. The examples are here. I'll go to there later after I give you some description about the regional economic integration. Over 50% of world trade today occurs under some form of preferential trade agreement signed by a group of countries. Economic bloc. What other blocks? We will look at it later. Cooperation nation obtain, the cooperating nations obtain, the countries that cooperate within the economic blocks, they obtain what? Increased product choices, productivity, living standard, lower prices and more efficient resource of use. Okay? I will give you example. Is it true or not? All this, is it true? Is it true? I'll give examples later after I show you the examples of those economic blocks. Okay. Some of the examples are European Union Economic Bloc, NAFTA Economic Bloc, Mercosur Economic Bloc, APEC Economic Bloc. I will show you the acronym of it, the full term of it later. ASEAN Economic Bloc. So, Economic Bloc means a geographic area consisting of two or more countries that agree to pursue economic integration by reducing tariff to eliminate protection. Take out one by one. Take out, take it out. Just now they put back, isn't it? Now, take it out one by one. By reducing tariff and other barriers such as quota, administrative barrier, subsidy, so on, to the cross-border flow of products, services, capital, and more advanced cases, labor. This is the purpose of economic bloc. Take it out one by one. That is economic bloc. There are five potential level of regional integration. Five potential level of regional integration. Very colorful graph. Learn how to draw this. Learn how to draw this when you got free time. There are few level of integration: free trade area, custom union, common market, economic and monetary union, political union. I will explain one by one. And what are the characteristics of those level of integration? These are the characteristics for this level of integration. So, I want to show you the pictorial graph first, then I will explain one by one. Then we come back to this again. So, if you look at in a circle, just now is in a bar format. Now, if you look at a circle, free trade area is in the middle. Custom union, next common market, next economic union, next is political union. So, if you look at the NAFTA is here, free trade area, whereas European Union is somewhere here, economic union. There is no political union so far. Okay? There is no. So, now we go one by one. Then we go back to the circle and the bar graph. Level of regional integration. First level, free trade area. First level is free trade area. Simplest, the most simple, most common arrangement. Member countries agree to gradually eliminate, not eliminate yet, gradually eliminate formal trade barriers within the bloc, while each member maintains an independent international trade policy with countries outside the bloc. One example is NAFTA. Canada, Mexico, and the US. This is Canada, right? This is US, and this is Mexico. So, in 1994, NAFTA was formally established, and it is facilitated by this Mercosur program, through which US firms located factories just south of the US border to access low-cost labor without significant tariff. So, they went down until the border of Mexico, and some went inside Mexico as well. So, NAFTA eliminated tariff and most non-tariff barrier for products and services. That means from Canada can go, the product can go to US, and from US the product can go to Mexico, and Mexico can go to US and to Canada, and from Canada can go to Mexico. There is no tariff, progressively been eliminated. Established trade and investment rules, uniform custom procedures and intellectual property rights. I give one example, uniform custom procedure. That means, I give one example, the truck can go from Mexico, can straight go to US, can straight go to Canada without much inspection by the customs. Before NAFTA, the truck go to US from Mexico must stop and change the truck to the US truck. Then go to Canada, must change to a Canada truck. With NAFTA, the truck from Mexico no need to change anymore. Just stop for basic inspection, then go to US, then go to Canada and return back. No tax. Provided procedures for settling trade disputes. Let's say they got any trade disputes between Mexico, US and Canada, they can go to NAFTA. NAFTA will settle their trade disputes because they have some procedures for them to follow. That is NAFTA. And look at some of the key features of NAFTA countries. The exports are very high. The GDP per capita also very high. The GDP in terms of billions and the population is what you can see, the population of those countries over here. Right? Some of the results from NAFTA, then we go to another trading block. Trade among the member more than triple. Very good. And now exceeds 1 trillion per year. Between 1994 to 2008, annual export from Canada to Mexico more than double after the NAFTA. Mexico to the US grow, wow, 220 billion. The US to Mexico, the US to Canada. Mexican exports to the US more than quadruple. Quadruple means 4x, you know, 4x. Access to Canada and the US have launched many Mexican firms in industries such as cars, electronic, textile, medical product and services. Even the Mexican companies also going out. Last time, no industry. Now they also got industry which they are moving to Canada. And these are some of the figures to show how Mexico as a leading emerging market in the world. Mexico is one of the emerging economy, similar to Malaysia, but they are very far progress compared to Malaysia now because of NAFTA. Okay? We go back to the earlier slide, then we look at other trading blocks. Similar to free trade area, except the members harmonize their trade policies toward non-member countries by enacting common tariff and non-tariff barrier on import from non-member countries, such as Mercosur is a good example. Over here, they eliminate between the bloc, but they have independent trade policy with other non-members. But over here, they have common tariff and non-tariff barrier with other non-members. Over here is independent policy with non-members. Over here is common tariff with the non-members. Let's look at Mercosur now. The leading economic bloc in South America, we call this Mercosur, launched in 1991. Who are the member countries? Argentina, Brazil, Paraguay and Uruguay. Paraguay, Uruguay, not much things to talk about. Brazil, popular for football, isn't it? So these countries come under the Mercosur Common. What do you call it just now? Custom Union, where they have common tariff with other members. Non-members. Let me go back. Okay. Establish free movement of products. Remember, free movement and services, common external tariff and trade policy, and coordinated monetary and fiscal policies between the members. And in the future, may be integrated with NAFTA or DACA as part of a future free trade of the Americas. In the future, could be. So some of the key features of the member countries, look at the population here, then the GDP per capita, and export as a percentage of GDP, very high, after they become the members of the Mercosur. What's the population of people in Argentina? 40 million. What's the population of cow in Argentina? I think more than the people, you know. Yeah. Population of cow in Argentina, more than the people in Argentina. Next, common market. Number three, common market. Common market means what? Like a custom union, almost same as a custom union earlier, number two, except products, services, and factors of production such as capital, labor, and technology can move freely among the member countries. For example, EU countries put in place many common labor and economic policies. So over here, the labor also can move, you know. Earlier, can I? But not as much is in the next common market. The free movement of labor here is more, the degree of freedom is much more higher in common market compared to the custom union. I repeat, the degree of freedom in common market is higher than the custom union. We'll go to the examples later, because it is almost same as the next one we are going, economic union. Like a common market, but members also aim for common fiscal and monetary policies and standardized commercial regulation. Wow. The EU is moving toward an economic union by forming a monetary union with a single currency, we call it Euro. So over here, we just talk about the services, product, labor, factors of production, but over here we're talking about monetary policies, standardized commercial regulation, and so on. Okay, so European Union is a good example for this, and also for the common market. We'll look at it later. The most active economic blocks over here. This is NAFTA, Mercosur, European Union. So European Union is one of the most active economic blocks in the world. Okay, so over here you can see the one in a yellow color, European Union member countries such as Finland, Sweden. Finland famous for what? Nokia phone from Finland. Even I told you the story about Finland, isn't it? About Nokia phone, Sweden, famous for what? Sweden. people in Sweden like to drink coffee with sweet, with chocolate and so on, but they don't put sugar in the coffee. That's why in Sweden very less people are diabetic. No diabetic or not? Kencing manis. Very less, because they take coffee without sugar, but they eat a lot of sugar. That means in terms of chocolate and so on. In Malaysia, we eat chocolate, we eat cakes, and also we drink the coffee with sweet, with sugar. That's why in Malaysia a lot of diabetics. Sweden, these are people in Sweden. Denmark is here, Poland, Germany. Germany famous for technical knowledge. They are very good at technical knowledge. That's why they can produce such a good car in the world, such as BMW and Mercedes-Benz, and also Volkswagen. Poland, then France is here. France famous for? France famous for wine. The best wine come from France. The color of the wine is almost same as the blood. You know blood or not? Almost same as the color of the blood. Okay? Then Spain, Portugal, all are here. You see here? Switzerland not a member. But they are a member for the European Free Trade Association, EFTA. Norway also not a member. Iceland also not a member. You see, European Union now under a big problem. What problem is that? Economic recession in European Union countries. Okay? But there are three countries escape. The countries are Switzerland, Norway, and Iceland escaped. Why? Because they never use the euro dollar. Just now we say economic bloc are very important, isn't it? Yes, it's important to reduce the protectionism. But sometimes there are also some drawbacks, which I will teach you later. Some of the drawbacks of the economic blocs. So, Switzerland, Norway and Iceland escaped the recession. That's why Switzerland now doing very well. Norway also doing very well. Iceland also doing very well. Okay? So, this is the difference between EFTA and the EU. Shortly we call EU. Okay, these are some of the key features of the countries of the European Union. You can look at it later. As what I mentioned to you just now, whenever the trading blocks are formed, normally the GDP become higher, especially the export as a percentage of GDP, normally be very high. Above 30% normally, above 30. Those are active nation, above 30%, which is very good. EU, a full-fledged economic union. Market access, tariff and most non-tariff barriers have been eliminated. Very good, isn't it? Common market, barriers to cross-border movement of production. Labor can move freely. Capital also can move freely. Technology also can move freely without tax or any barriers. No custom check on the technology. Can move freely. Trade rules, cross-national customs procedures and regulations have been eliminated, which has streamlined transportation and logistics within Europe. They even have underground train from London to France. You don't have to check anything, just take your passport and can go to France without even having a France passport. You don't have to have a France access, just can go with a London passport, can. And the trucks cannot, no need to change from Spain go to Portugal, for example, no need to change trunks. The customs do not check thoroughly. They check for the important contraband, for example. Other than that, they let go. So, trade routes become easier, streamlined. Standard harmonization, technical standard, regulation, enforcement have been harmonized. That means, become as one. As though I am from London, I am going to France, as though France is part of London. What do we call that? Harmonize. I am from Portugal, I go to France, as though France is part of Portugal. The rules become harmonized. The custom laws become harmonized. People treat you as their own citizen. Very good, you know, actually. European Union is one of the wonderful trading blocs in the world. Let's say, now you go and study in France. You can go with the study pass from France, can go to all the countries in European Union. Freely. Good, isn't it? So, do your masters over there. Do your masters. So, you can travel around European Union countries. Okay? Common physical, monetary taxation and social welfare policies are also harmonizing. Okay, this is a structure of the EU. Consists of Council of European Union, European Commission, European Parliament, and also European Court of Justice. I want to stress over here, European Court of Justice. Just now, NAFTA. Whenever there is a dispute, they go to NAFTA. Same in the European Union countries, whenever there is a dispute, let's say there is a dispute between Spain and Portugal because of something, regulation, which they do not like, they can go to this ECJ. Interpret and enforces EU law. Anyone violate the law that been established by the EU, they can go to the ECJ, European Court of Justice, to get justice. So, this is some of the structure that is available in the EU. European Union has how many members? 27 members. Founders members are Belgium, Italy, France and so on. Some of the new members are from the middle Eastern Europe, Poland, Hungary, Czech Republic and so on. You see or not, because of the EU, many factories are going to EU. For example, Peugeot, Citroën, from France, they have factories in Czech Republic. Peugeot and Citroën from France, they have factories in Czech Republic. Hyundai also have factory where? In Slovakia. Why they come there? They come here because the car can be moving around to other part of the European Union without paying tax. That's wonderful to have factory in European Union countries. Suzuki Japan has a factory in Hungary. Okay. Do we have Proton Saga factory in European Union? See, they don't capture the opportunity. If one of you employed in Proton, one of these days, maybe after you graduate, please go and tell the CEO, have a factory there, so that the car can be sold other part of the EU without a tax. But the question the CEO may ask you, who will buy Proton in European country? Then you can tell back the CEO, let's improve our design. Then the CEO will tell you, come, give me idea about the design. You as a management student, don't have to worry. Call your friend from the engineering faculty to come and design the car. Isn't it? Yes. So, these are some of the countries in ASEAN. For example, our country is there. Myanmar, Laos, Vietnam. Vietnam is a new member of ASEAN. Wants to foster freer trade between member countries and to achieve some cooperation in their industrial policies. ASEAN Free Trade Area, AFTA, between the 6 original members of ASEAN came into effect in 2003. So ASEAN AFTA are moving towards establishing a free trade zone, but not so successful as NAFTA or EU or Mercosur. APEC, Asia Pacific Economic Cooperation. They have 21 members including the US, Japan and China. So wants to increase multilateral cooperation, and member states account for 51% of world GNP and 49% of world trade. These are some of the facts and figures about APEC. Other economy blocks are CARICOM, CAN, ASEAN already mentioned just now, and CER. And these are some of the map of those countries. So there's nothing much to talk about them. Why? Even the ASEAN and the AFTA, nothing much to talk about them. Because they are not as integrated economically and politically as NAFTA, EU and Mercosur. Now we go to the next part. Why do nations pursue economic integration? Why? This is to answer here. Why? Why? Number one, expand the market size. Increase size of the marketplace for firms to do business. If you perform your trading in France, you access to all the country in European Union. So that's how you expand your market size. Another example always I give you in the class is Lakshmi Mittal. The HQ is in Luxembourg, which is a European Union country, and they sell steel. And this is an India-based company. Normally India, they have the HQ in India, right? But they have the HQ in Luxembourg. Why? Because they can expand their market size. If they go to Luxembourg as a HQ, they access to all the 27 EU member countries without paying a single cent of tax. That's why they have it in the Luxembourg, the HQ. Expand the market size. This is a good example about how to expand your market size by becoming the member of the economic bloc. Number two, enhance productivity and economies of scale. Of course, of course. When you go to one country in EU, you already have your economy of scale, right? When you have your HQ in Luxembourg, for example, they can have factories in any of the 27 countries. So your economy of scale is achieved. Bigger market facility, economies of scale. Bigger market facilitate economy of scale. Internationalization inside the bloc helps firms learn to compete outside the bloc. Yes. And competition and efficient resource usage inside the bloc leads to lower prices for bloc consumers. Yes. When the market is big, you can produce in such a bigger scale, we call it economy of scale. And with that, the lower price is achieved. And you even can compete with those companies or countries outside the bloc because you already achieved economy of scale. So these are the reasons why nations pursue economic integration. Why we have economic bloc? Why? Expand the size, improve productivity, economy of scale. The third one is attract investment from outside the bloc. A good example which I'll show you just now is the Lakshmi Mittal. Other examples are these countries. Just now I'll show you Suzuki, Hyundai, Peugeot, all are being attracted to those countries in the bloc, and they are from outside the bloc. They come inside the bloc to expand their investment. Acquire stronger defensive and political posture. So when you become the member of the bloc, you have a strong background, stronger support from the member countries in terms of trade, in terms of political dispute can be settled in the bloc, within the bloc, like the ECJ. So they have very good support in terms of politics within the bloc. What factors help regional integration succeed? So now we are moving from the why to what factors help regional integration succeed. You see, not all the blocs are successful, isn't it? Just now I told you. Some are not so successful, not so successful like the APEC, after not so successful. Why? Could be some of the reasons here. Here they explain why they are successful, for example, like EU and so on, NAFTA and so on. First is economic similarity. Strong similarity on wage rates, they have similar economic conditions, they have other factors help ensure success, for example, like EU countries. They are almost the same in terms of economic factors, wage rate, monetary policies, fiscal policies, almost the same. Political similarity as well. Example, countries should have similar political systems, share similar ideology, they have similar principles, similar political system, that makes them another success. For example, in European Union countries, most of them are democracy based countries, democracy, capital base. Another one could be democracy socialism, like Switzerland. That's why they are not part of it. Why Switzerland not part of the European Union? Because of the different political system, socialism plus democracy. That's why they are not part of the system. The rest, all democracy. So they can be part of the EU. So political similarity is very important. Similarity of culture and language. For example, like Mercosur and Australia, New Zealand, CR are similar in this way. For example, in terms of language, culture, almost the same. Mercosur, Brazil, Argentina, Paraguay, Uruguay, almost the same in terms of culture. European Union also, in terms of culture, they are almost the same. Not 100% the same, but almost the same. And of course, the other one is also the geographic proximity. Normally, the economic blocks are those countries are connected together, geographic proximity. For example, you see, and all connected together, right? Then also connected together. Then also the European Union country also connected together. APEC connected together or not? ASEAN connected together or not? They are all far apart, even though they are in the same region. They are not connected together. That's why it could be another reason why they are not so successful. Except for Malaysia, Thailand, Vietnam, the rest all is apart. Drawbacks of the regional integration. What are the drawbacks or disadvantages? But it's manageable. It's manageable. Nothing over here is absolute drawbacks. Some of the bit are manageable drawbacks. As barriers fall, trade is generated inside the bloc. That means they just do trade within the bloc only. They forget about the rest of the world. That's one drawback. But European Union, I don't think so, they fall into this drawback. They fall into this trap. No. Trade diversion. As within the bloc trade becomes more attractive because of the removal of the protectionism, member countries discontinue some trade with non-member countries. This is not right. We should not discontinue our relationship with the non-member countries. Okay, but this can be the potential drawback. But I don't think so any other blocs are doing that. NAFTA, EU and Mercosur, they are not doing this. But this could be the potential drawbacks. Aggregate effect. National trade patterns are altered. More trade occurs inside the bloc and less trade occurs with countries outside the bloc. So, the aggregate effect is eliminated. For example, you should have inside and outside to balance out the trade. So, once you have the inside only, outside is not coming in, then your aggregate effect is altered. That means, sometimes your inside trade is better, outside is not good, so you have the aggregate effect. Sometimes inside is better, outside is not bad. So, you are negative, positive become balance. We call it aggregate effect. So, now you remove the one, only got inside only. So, if anything happened to your inside, outside is not helping you. We call it aggregate effect. In other words, is layman term is there is no positive negative balance. Another one is potential loss of national identity. But not so true, actually, not so true. Increased cross-border contact makes members more similar to each other. For example, in response to NAFTA, Canada has restricted the ability of US movie and TV producers to invest in Canadian film and broadcasting industries because they think US culture is influencing the Canada culture. But you can't stop nowadays. People can watch in the YouTube. You cannot stop totally. So, loss of national identity potential, but I don't think so. It is something that is going to happen. Sacrifice of autonomy. So, in later stages, a central authority is set up to manage the bloc's affairs. Members must sacrifice some autonomy to the central authority, such as control over their own economy, for example, like Britain in the EU. So, sometimes they think, oh, I cannot manage my own economy. The European Union is controlling my economy. So, they will have this kind of disparities. We call that sacrifice of the autonomy. Okay, please bear with me for another 6 more slides, then we are done. Drawbacks of regional integration, we continue. Transfer of power to advantage firm. This can happen. Yes. Those most competitive will be more powerful. The one less competitive will die off because of the economic bloc's freedom. So, integration can concentrate economic power. As I mentioned to you, they become more powerful. The one less competitive cannot survive unless they go out from the bloc. Failure of small or weaker firms. This will support the earlier argument. So, the weak cannot survive, only the stronger survive. But I want to ask you, who is strong, who is weak? We cannot call a person weak because there is someone always weaker than the other person, isn't it? Then you go to the weakest person in the world, or weakest country, or weakest nation, there could be another one always weaker than the other one. Okay? So, in this case, the weak will normally go out from the bloc and do business elsewhere. So, I think it's not a big problem actually. Not a big problem. Corporate restructuring and job loss. As I have tell you, only the strongest survive and those weak, they have to go outside the country and the local one may lose their jobs. So, implications of the regional integration for the firm. What are the implications? Good and the bad. What are the implications? Internationalization by firm inside the economic bloc, which is a good news. For example, like Home Depot. Home Depot expanded in Mexico following passage of the NAFTA agreement. Expansion into neighboring countries provides valuable experience and they are worldwide now. Home Depot, for example. So, it helps firm to internationalize, which is very good news, or we can say it's a very positive implication for the firms. Number two, rationalization of operation. As I mentioned to you, since they can move freely, if I don't do well in France, let's go to Spain. If I cannot get a cheaper labor in France, let me go to Spain. That we call rationalization operation. Like in Malaysia now, if I cannot get a cheaper labor, I need to survive over here. I cannot go anywhere. I can't even go to Singapore because of the customs, trade law and so on. But in EU, I can go anywhere. We call this rationalization of operation. Merger and acquisition are becoming so easily occurring in the EU because of the freedom. Okay? So, let's say I'm weak, then a stronger one always can merge with me. Or the stronger one can acquire me. I have no problem. No problem. Because as strong, my company don't die. As strong, we have opportunity for us to acquire, merger. At least we have the job opportunities in the trading blocks. That's why I told you just now, the weaker is not a problem. Either you can go out or you can stay inside to get merged or acquired by someone stronger. Regional products and marketing strategy, that means the products can move freely, the marketing become more easily happening in the region, and also the companies become more popular outside because of the international strategy. Once they're successful in the trading block, they can always can go out to become investors. So the future of the trading blocks is, this is going to grow. The one that is weak now, for example, like AFTA, APEC, ASEAN, will also grow in the future, because this is very, very important. As I mentioned to you, crucial to eliminate protectionism. So, moving forward, the regional economic integration will become part and parcel of international trade.